The following program is a special presentation of Fox Sports Net.
Fox Sports Net welcomes you to a cool and sunny winter day here at the place that racing fans call The Rock, Rockingham, North Carolina. Today, with the memory of Dale Earnhardt still fresh on everyone's mind, Winston Cup cars will attempt to qualify, battle for the pole in tomorrow's Winston Cup stop here in Rockingham. The driver stepping in for Dale Earnhardt's racing team is rookie Kevin Harvick. As you get a look at the white 29 car, Richard Childress saying he will never run a black number 3 car again. Childress thinks that Harvick can meet the challenge and handle the responsibility of stepping in for a legend.
You know, I'd like to say one thing that, you know, Dale Earnhardt was probably the best race car driver there ever is going to be in NASCAR, and nobody will ever replace him. And I think we all know that. So I would hope that you guys don't expect me to replace him, because nobody ever will.
And this morning, Dale Earnhardt Jr., as you see, getting ready to return to racing for the first time since the tragic loss of his father, Steve Park, in the one car, also a part of DEI, Dale Earnhardt Enterprises and racing team. He's hoping to get his focus back on track. Meanwhile, Michael Waltrip, who won last week's emotional Daytona 500, his first ever Winston Cup victory in an Earnhardt car, had some trouble this morning already in Rockingham. Take a look here, as he had some difficulties that he'll need to make the field after qualifying, or need that to be in tomorrow's race. Concerned about the condition of his car, and emotionally spent, obviously, considering the week that he had been through. Let's get the latest on the developments regarding Michael Waltrip and head down to the pit area with Steve Burns.
Thanks, Chris. The team is swarming over the car. This is a backup car. Winston Cup technical director Gary Nelson confirmed that Michael Waltrip did blow a motor. Now, the team was scheduled to go out third in an attempt to qualify. They will work as quickly as they can to get this backup car ready. If there is good news in this situation, Chris, it is that Michael Waltrip did have an opportunity to test this car here at Rockingham, so it is not a completely unknown quantity. Chris?
All right, thank you, Steve. So Michael Waltrip concerned here in Rockingham on the North Carolina Speedway, as he will need to qualify. The defending champion Bobby Labonte won last year's race. You will see it live on Fox tomorrow. Hi, once again, I'm Chris Myers, and welcome to the North Carolina Motor Speedway as we come to you from just above the finish line here at The Rock. And the focus all week, understandably, has been on mourning the loss of Dale Earnhardt. But now drivers must try and put their attention back on the track. Former Winston Cup champion crew chief Jeff Hammond is with us and has been a part of certainly a very, very difficult week. You've spent some time in the garage area speaking with the drivers and the members of the racing teams. Jeff, we saw with Michael Waltrip maybe a little bit of an emotional fallout of what he's been through. It must be difficult for all the drivers to put their focus on racing after the loss of Earnhardt.
Chris, in all my years of racing, I cannot remember when I've ever seen anything quite like this. We've had these situations come up before, unfortunately, but I've never known a garage area to be so somber and guys to be so, you know, basically down right now. It's a situation where everybody's got to kind of pick themselves up. And in Michael's case, I think he was trying maybe a little bit too hard. He really wants to make a statement here about winning the 500 and coming back and the DEI car run good. So maybe he was just trying to carry too much and it got away from him.
Some of the drivers saying that, hey, you know, when I get to the track, I'll be okay. But this morning they're here and they're still not okay. They're still dealing with the loss of Earnhardt.
It's going to take a long time. This is a big hole, and it's going to take a long time to even kind of begin to heal up.
And there are a number of questions that we're looking for answers on, Jeff. And the latest development, yesterday's revelation that the left side of Dale Earnhardt's seatbelt, the lap belt, came apart. And this has raised further questions about Earnhardt's actual accident.
What we're doing this morning is we're updating you on our investigation, and what we have found in investigating Dale Earnhardt's car from the Sunday accident is that there was a broken left lap belt. We don't know why, we don't know how, we don't know when yet. All we know is that there was a broken belt at this point.
The lap belt typically, or in all cases, connect to the roll cage on the right side. It would come up. This buckle would be about where your belt buckle would be. And then this side would connect to the roll cage on the left side. What the people that came to the scene to Dale Earnhardt's aid found was the buckle was latched like this. And what we found later on in looking at the car was that when they unbuckled it, this piece ended up on the floor of the car and this piece was still connected to the roll cage. It was separated right in this area. We've never seen it, and we've talked to people who are in the business to produce lap belts who have told us they've never seen it. So in 52 years of NASCAR Winston Cup racing, this is the first one of these that we've seen.
If we knew that there was something that we could do, we would do it. But inasmuch as that all we know at this point that we've got a separated lap belt, that in the 52-year history of this sport and in the industry that develops these parts and pieces has never seen before, we don't have a conclusion today that gives us the ability to react to it.
NASCAR President Mike Helton will join us tomorrow to talk about the issues surrounding the loss of Dale Earnhardt as his memory is still here in full force. All right, for more on today's qualifying, some thoughts on some of the things we just heard, let's go upstairs to our play-by-play crew, Mike Joy, Darrell Waltrip, and Larry McReynolds. Mike?
Well, this is certainly a new wrinkle, Mike Helton's announcement, in the face of our review of what looked to be a survivable crash last Sunday at Daytona. Your reaction to Helton's announcement, Darrell?
Well, as a driver, the driver's compartment is your responsibility. You work very closely with your, there's always one guy on the team that puts the seat in. There's one guy on the team that works with the driver to get the leg supports, the headrest, all that area to get it like the driver wants it. So the thing I don't understand is how this happened. It's confusing to me because I know Larry, and you can allude to this some, I'm sure. Every team has a procedure that they go through to be sure that everything in that car is like it's supposed to be with the driver's involvement.
Well, I've got to ditto what everybody's saying. In 20 years, I've never seen anything like this happen. And I've got to look at the two parties involved with this. I was a crew chief at Richard Childress Racing for 4 years. I know the schedule of parts there. At the end of every season, things like seat belts got thrown away, new ones installed. But this was a brand new race car with brand new seat belts in Dale Earnhardt's car. Also, Bill Simpson of Simpson Racing Equipment, these guys have done more for safety in motorsports than anybody. I mean, not only a NASCAR, but Formula One, IndyCar. And I know something like this did not get through the cracks at Simpson Safety Equipment.
As a journalist, Mike Helton's announcement leaves me with far more questions than answers. There are sophisticated ways of measuring the remains of those belts and of going over the car, and I'm sure those things are being done. And I'm going to withhold comment until we have more answers, because I have a lot of questions. Following the NASCAR announcement, Dale Earnhardt Jr. made this statement.
I do want to say that any notion or any idea that or any blame placed upon anyone, whether it be Sterling Marlin or anybody else for that matter, is ridiculous and will not be tolerated. I just think it's completely incredible that some of the things that I've heard or been told about.
I think Earnhardt Jr. showed very incredible composure during that press conference, and we certainly agree with the statements he just made.
Yeah, I mean, this is no time to blame someone for what happened. It's a racing accident, and certainly what happened is very emotional. But this is no time to let emotion override good sense.
All right, we'll have more a bit later, but right now, let's return to Chris Myers as we prepare for qualifying.
All right, thank you, Mike. And there is a driver's cry and echoing for safer conditions. We have a lot to cover for you, and the memory of Dale Earnhardt will be a part of the entire racing coverage. Fox Racing continuing its coverage all weekend, up to and including tomorrow's Winston Cup race on Fox as we honor the racing legend Dale Earnhardt. NASCAR this morning at 10 o'clock Eastern. This is tomorrow, then the race itself, NASCAR Victory Lane, to wrap things up. You're watching qualifying for the Rockingham 400 on Fox Sports Net.
Welcome back to the North Carolina Speedway for pole qualifying. is set to begin. On the practice chart this morning, Steve Park, Bobby Labonte, Dale Jarrett, Michael Waltrip, who's now gone to a backup car, Mark Martin and Jeremy Mayfield were the top half dozen in practice. It is a somber mood in the NASCAR garage area and on the qualifying line, Dick Berggren.
The mood among crew members is somber, to say the least. They are trying as best they can to focus on springs, shock absorbers, setups, anything but the last lap of the Daytona 500. We are not seeing the usual smiles, the games, the practical jokes, none of that. Dale Earnhardt was the hero of everybody here, and everybody here is trying as best they can to cope. To Matt Yoakum.
Dick, the Daytona 500 winner isn't the only driver feeling pressure. The drama meter is pegged by a small pack of teams that are working without the safety net of a provisional. Rookie Casey Atwood and veteran Kyle Petty know they have to turn in a stellar lap to guarantee a spot in Sunday's race, or they go home and spend the rest of the season feeling the hit in the points. Mike.
Thanks, Matt. Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car pushed into position on the qualifying line after inspection. He's well down the list. He'll be the 29th car to take time today.
You know, the best thing for everybody, the drivers, the crews, the team, all of us, the fans, us guys up here, is get these cars on the track, get some qualifying going here, get some excitement going, and get our minds off of what we've had to deal with all this week. Getting this thing back, get this show back on the road will be good therapy for everybody.
We got so many different elements here at Rockingham. This is the first race in the 2001 season where we're doing one round qualifying, two laps. We've always run only one lap here. And Darrell, tires are such an issue here gripping the racetrack. It's like we don't know if that second lap even means anything.
Let's go down and visit with the driver who was fastest in practice. Here's Dick.
It was a tough start to the day for Steve Park. He blew an engine almost immediately this morning, but then cut the quickest lap. Can you back that up in your time trial?
We certainly hope so. This whole Pennzoil team has really worked hard on this car. We had the opportunity to come down here and test. This is a car that we tested, and we ran well in testing. So threw a little bit of a curveball this morning going out there, cutting one lap and then having the engine go. But these guys really just jumped right on it, got the engine changed out. And our third lap on the racetrack was one of the fastest laps. So hopefully we got one more in her before today's out.
Good luck to you today, Steve.
The three Earnhardt team cars, the 1, the 8, and the 15, are here in their normal colors. A rumor circulated early in the week that they would all be painted black for this race. In truth, these cars had all been prepared for Rockingham before these teams left for Daytona, and the decision was made not to alter anything, but to continue on with their original plans and bring these cars in their traditional paint schemes. But every car here carries a decal like this. This particular decal is only on the Childress and Earnhardt owned cars. There is a similar design that is on every other car here. That looks like this. NASCAR is clearing a vehicle from the track, and then we will be ready to begin the process of qualifying and hopefully the healing. We will be right back.
We're close to the end of the qualifying session.
Qualifying begins for Sunday's Winston Cup race. Ward Burton and Bill Davis Dodge is the first driver on the clock. Seems the vehicle that was on track delaying qualifying was ours. It was two of our technicians in a golf cart adjusting one of the RoboCams, remote cameras built into the wall here at Rockingham. And I guess our technician wasn't quite mindful that NASCAR was ready to start qualifying. So here we go, and Ward Burton is the first car on the clock. Two laps of qualifying. They've reverted to two laps of qualifying in that there is only one round of qualifying for every Winston Cup race, with the exception of the Daytona 500. 23.623 the first lap for Ward Burton. 154.985 miles per hour. Second lap is slower by 5/100ths of a second. And Darrell, do we expect that'll be the pattern, that the first lap should be quickest?
Well, Larry and I we were kidding each other. Larry thought the second lap might be quicker, but quite honestly, quite honestly, I don't think that's the truth. I think that these guys are trained to do one lap. That's what we do normally. I think they'll go out and they'll get all they can get out of that car in their first lap.
I think the only way the second lap would be beneficial is if you mess up bad the first lap. And the temperatures are getting warmer now. Yep. And when a tire is cold, it just don't grip the racetrack as good. And that's one reason this morning maybe a few cars, I mean, they started practice at 7:45, maybe was a little quicker on their second lap just from heat.
Probably so.
Now remember, this will set the entire field, one round of qualifying. Here is Brett Bodine driving his own number 11 Ford.
What amazed me going through the garage this morning, Brett Bodine was one of the cars that tested down here. Everybody used to focus on Daytona, kind of take Rockingham for granted. 18 of the 45 teams here tested Rockingham over the winter.
A lot of teams realize that they need to test the first four races. They even went to Vegas and Atlanta because some of these teams have no provisionals, so they got to be sure that they're ready when they get here.
Dick Berggren.
Well, Brett Bodine is lucky that he's on the racetrack at all. He went out for practice this morning, and immediately he lost both the transmission and the rear gears. He did not get very much practice time today. Mike?
23.814 on the first lap, 153.7 miles per hour for Bodine. And his second lap is faster, 23.612. He is quickest at 155 miles an hour.
Okay, here's your dollar back.
Okay.
That dollar's gonna go back and forth all day.
I had it for one car.
I think it was a dollar for every car, right?
No,
oh my goodness.
You got the dollar.
Too much accounting for me, Steve Burns.
Thanks, Mike. With us is Steve Meehl, the technical director at Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. Talk us through what needs to happen with the 15 car, what the crew has had to do since the accident, Steve.
Well, fortunately for the Napa guys, they tested this particular spare car down here about a month ago and it ran real fast. So it had the right suspension stuff in it, the right springs, the right shocks, the right sway bars. We elected to put a honest-to-God qualifying motor in it because Michael has no provisionals and we only get one shot to make this race. So we probably could have qualified with the other engine, but Richie Gilmore had a better bullet in the chamber, so we went ahead and shoved it in. We're weighing the car out right now. It'll go through all the NASCAR inspections. We'll go late in line. NASCAR's good enough to let us go late. But actually, to be realistic about it, the car was pretty much ready to run when it got pushed in the truck Wednesday night.
All right, thanks, Steven. Guys, I need to make a correction. The 15 did not blow a motor. The one car did. And now we'll go over to Matt Yoakum.
And Ward Burton was the first driver out today, Steve. Ward, you dropped about a tenth from your practice time to your qualifying time. Any idea where you lost it?
Ever since the sun started coming out, we just couldn't get the nose to turn. The Caterpillar dodge is really tight right now. We're going to have to do some work on it here in a while.
Ricky Rudd's first lap is fastest so far, 23.488, 155.8 miles an hour. And his second lap is quicker by 0.04 of a second, 23.484. The track record set by Rusty Wallace last year, 23.167. That's 158 miles an hour. Qualifying continues in a moment on Fox Sports Net. Welcome back to North Carolina Speedway. Bobby Labonte, the Winston Cup champion of the year 2000, is the fourth driver to qualify.
And he really got down in turn one well, and then you saw him working his hands. You can see his hands on the wheel there. You really have to keep the car, you have to fight with the car off the corners here, particularly off turn two.
He was fast through turn three and four there, faster than anybody I've had.
And he is, Larry, 23.459 on the first lap, 156 miles an hour.
Yeah, that car really looked good. It's right on the bottom, and he's in the gas, and he's coming up out of those corners really well.
Folks, we concentrate on the time on the stopwatch, the seconds. That's what the drivers and that's what the crews measure, and that's what's of record. The conversion of miles per hour is a convenience for the fans, but we are looking primarily at the times on the stopwatch, and Labonte's second lap is slower.
This is not the car that he won the spring race with here. They tore that car up in a practice wreck at Darlington Southern 500. This car has run one race at Phoenix, Arizona, at the end of last year.
Dick?
Well, we have a new tire, Sterling Marlin, and we have a cold day. How much grip have you got out there?
The first lap, getting going, especially through three and four coming to the green, it's a little skaty. But once you get back down here, it hooks up pretty good. But we took off this morning, like spun out coming out of the pits on the bonsai run, and then the power steering belt come loose. So we don't really know what we got.
Okay, well, good luck with it.
What he was talking about, a bonsai run, what that is, that's a mock qualifying run in practice.
Got the rookie out there now.
Kurt Busch from out of the NASCAR Truck Series driving Jack Roush's unsponsored Ford. Excuse me. This is carrying the same paint scheme it had on it at Daytona, or similar. RouschRacing.com is listed there. That is the team rather than a sponsor. And a little
Boy, he's wobbling there. That second turn is really, really hard to get. You want to come out of there wide open, and that's your goal when you go out to run these qualifying laps. But it's very difficult to do, as you can see.
He's quicker through three and four, but I think one and two is going to be the culprit on this second lap.
First lap, 23.600. The second lap is slower. So the first lap of 155.1 will be Kurt Busch's lap of record. He is third fastest behind Bobby Labonte and Ricky Rudd. Now, folks, you will see every car qualify. You won't see it at home in exactly real time. If we have to go to commercial, excuse me, that's a silly statement. When we go to commercial,
when we go to commercial,
we will stop the tape of our recording qualifying and pick up pretty much where we left off, so that for the rest of the season, you will see every car run. Here is Johnny Benson, the MBV Motorsports Pontiac. Reed Morton, Nelson Bowers, Tom Beard, with a corporate partner in the ownership of that team. And something that's new to NASCAR, where a sponsor owns half the car, rather than just participating by funding the team's operation. But here's Benson, former ASA and NASCAR Busch Series champion. 23.603, fourth fastest on his first lap, 155.1.
And you notice the grill, it's got the orange tape on it. Car's taped up what we call solid. There's the very little opening, just right below the Grand Prix sign. There might be a little crack, just a little area.
He's quicker through three and four on his second lap, run a little bit lower.
He is faster, despite that bobble out of four, 23.584, 155.2. Johnny Benson moves up to third. Mike Skinner getting into one of the supplemental restraint devices. This one, I believe, is the Simpson device that wraps underneath the driver's armpit and then attaches to the back of the helmet. We'll show you the hands device a bit later on, and we'll be right back. Bobby Labonte, Ricky Rudd, Johnny Benson are the three fastest as Mike Wallace takes to the racetrack.
When you see those cars go into turn one and they're not right down on the white line when they enter that turn like Bobby Labonte was, then that's the driver driving in too hard and not enough grip. That's what he would be complaining about.
I believe that's what Mike Wallace did in three and four. Not very good down there.
Mike Wallace in Jim Smith's Ford, the first lap, 23.873, 153.3 miles an hour. He is seventh fastest. Matt?
And Mike, Ricky Rudd picked up his speed on his second lap, uncharacteristic to the other drivers. Ricky, did you change your line at all?
Well, Matt worked on it a little bit. The first lap, I didn't get a hold of the track like I wanted to, so sort of adjusted the way you got into the corner and tried to change a little bit. It was so close, so I don't even think you could hardly measure it. That's about what we'd run in practice, and I'd have to say that anytime we can run what we did in practice, we're usually pretty pleased with it. I don't know where it's going to end up, probably top five, top 10 somewhere.
Let's go up pit road to Dick Berger.
Matt Kenseth has had a tough morning. He timed 40th out of 45 cars. Matt, what have you done to the car to try to make it faster for this qualifying run?
Well, really, Robbie and I sat down and just tried to tighten the car up a little bit. We've been real loose off the corner and still not turning as good as we need to in the middle either. So we've had kind of two problems to try to fix, and we threw some stuff at it. Hopefully we can get a decent lap and get a decent spot to start.
They are rolling the dice, Mike Joy.
All right, here's the fastest car in practice, Steve Park.
And Mike, if you watch his line, you can see why. He's into one real hard, but down on the bottom, he picked the throttle up. He's not fighting the car off at two over there. And see how he's right around the white line coming through three and four. Assuming he's back in the throttle like he should be, it's going to be a good lap.
I believe it is going to be a good one.
It's the quickest so far, 23.410, 156.
Until the track's heating up, even though he was fastest in practice, that's almost a tenth slower than he run on the cooler temperatures this morning. Tires gripped a little better on the second lap this morning with the cool weather.
The car really looks good. It's right around the bottom of the racetrack. Right now it's down to the white line, and it's got plenty of power, and he's on the pole.
Second lap is slower by 9/100ths of a second, so Steve Park is quickest so far. That bumps Bobby Labonte off the pole, Matt.
And Mike, Bobby Labonte was second quick in practice to the one car, and now you're second quick to the one car in qualifying. Good lap, though, for you, Bob?
Yeah, it wasn't too bad. Guys did a good job. We didn't run but two runs prior to qualifying, and
you know, definitely a little bit better when it was colder, but, you know, lost a little bit of grip, but overall it was still pretty, it's pretty good.
Well, he certainly has a good race setup here. He won this event 1 year ago.
Thanks, Matt. Steve Park, driving a Dale Earnhardt car, is quickest. John Andretti in the Petty Enterprises Dodge.
This is a brand new car. In fact, Petty Enterprises, when they went to the Dodges over the winter, they built all new cars for all three race teams, did not use no of the old chassis, because again, the chassis for all makes are the same. It's the body and the engines that are different.
Andretti was 24th quickest in practice. First lap, 23.734, and that is eighth among the nine drivers who have run.
When he goes into turn one, he goes in too low and almost gets the left side tires down on the apron getting into that corner. And I believe that's hurting his speed through that turn particularly. Looks pretty good in three and four, but he needs to work on one and two.
Teammate Buckshot Jones up on top of the transporter. Looking on, John Andretti's second lap is slower. So he is eighth fastest out of nine drivers thus far.
And let's talk, you know, again, that's another Dodge. This is the first time we'll see the Dodges on a downforce track. Saw them at Daytona, they were obviously very fast there, but the downforce is what you're looking for here.
There was only one Dodge in the top 10 in practice. In fact, it was rookie Casey Atwood that was ninth.
Next on track will be Rick Mast. And at the top of our screen coming out of the Fox box, you see a list of all the drivers that have run and their qualifying time. Let's meet the fastest man so far. Matt?
Steve Park is currently the provisional pole sitter. Steve, you came here on a mission. How perfect was that lap?
Well, it's, you know, the weather's changing dramatically. We've never really practiced so early here before. And with the temperature being real cool, the sun's starting to come out, starting to warm things up, and it's getting back to the old Rockingham that we know. So just slipping and sliding. I mean, Dale Jarrett's got a good race car. We thought Bobby Labonte would be real good. So it's pretty close to what we practiced. And I don't know, it's just been an emotional week, you know. So, you know, we'd love to get the pole and do it for Dale, because we surely miss him.
Certainly would be a great day to pick up the pole for the Big E. Mike?
Park has started seven races at Rockingham, but his best previous start, 17th. Here's Rick Mast, the Rockbridge Baths, yeah, Virginia driver's first lap, 23.844, ninth fastest.
Yeah, Rick's car is really, the rear end of that car is bouncing around a lot. I think he needs to possibly consider working on his shock package, because three and four is a little wavy as you exit, and that can really upset the car, and his car was doing a lot of moving around.
His second lap is quicker, Darrell, 23.805, but it's still only good for ninth fastest of the 10 drivers that have run. Steve?
Guys, work continues on the number 15 car of Michael Waltrip. Crew Chief Scott Eggleston saying they're gonna fire it up, check the water and oil temperatures, and then go ahead and push it through inspection.
This morning in practice, Michael crashed his primary car, and they're now preparing the backup. He was scheduled to be the third driver out on track to qualify, and now he'll run later in the day.
A couple years ago, he did the same thing in the morning practice and hopped in his backup car and qualified in the top 10. So it's a setback, but not major, I don't think.
Robert Presley is on the speedway.
He's not going to be happy with this lap, and he was pretty fast in practice. He was seventh fastest.
But Doug Baywell and Mark Wallace Ford is 23.811, 10th fastest out of 11.
Sometimes when a driver goes out to qualify, he's so pumped up, and he will literally overdrive the car. Many times the crew chief will stand on the top of the truck and holler at you, slow down, buddy, slow down and go faster. I know that's contrary to what you might believe, but sometimes you can back off a little early and make a whole lot better lap.
Second lap for Presley is slower. Dick Berggren?
Terry Labonte has won the pole for this race three times. What's it going to take today to win the pole, Terry?
Well, I don't know. We're running pretty good. I don't think we're a pole contender, but every time I've been down here and won the pole, I think we've unloaded off the truck and been like one of the fastest. So we're running pretty good. I think we've got a good race car. We've really got a race set up in here. Just, you know, qualify it and be ready for practice later.
Okay, go get him. Mike?
On the speedway, number 21 of Elliott Sadler.
Mike, one of the things about one round of qualifying and then happy hour, these guys probably usually qualify with low fuel, about 5 gallons of fuel in the car, and they get a lot of lead down low that way. They got to be 3,400 pounds when they go across the scale. They do a lot of things to qualify, and they're going to have to get it all done and change back over to a race setup in a hurry. That may be why some of them are qualifying with a race setup.
First lap for Sadler Darrell, 23.778, 153.9 miles an hour. That's ninth quickest.
He was another one that was probably too low in turn one. He got those left side tires below the white line, and that'll shoot you up the racetrack because the apron below the white line is a little bit different degree than the actual corner itself.
Yeah, that apron's virtually flat, and it's, I think, 24 degrees up on the speedway.
Yeah, it just unloads it. It unloads the car so badly when you hit the apron. You can hit it going into one. You can hit it coming off. That's really the line you want, but you got to get right on it.
Sadler picked up 25 thousandths on his second lap. 23.750 will be his time of record. He's ninth fastest so far.
You know, definitely, Darrell, I want to allude to what you said a while ago. This is one racetrack where if you can overdrive it, you would think the harder you drive a race car, the faster you're going to go. But you overdrive that intro, it kills the whole rest of the corner and will slow you down.
Yeah, watch Sadler.
See there, he dips the left side wheels right below that line right there, and that gets you in trouble, shoots it up the racetrack. See, he should be down here right now, so he's up the racetrack.
And you know what he's saying? Boys, it turned in good.
Yes.
Yeah, it turned in too good.
Ron Hornaday, the NASCAR Truck Series champion, driving for A.J. Foyt.
Well, he's right around the bottom.
Yeah, Felipe Lopez, the crew chief on that car, he's usually got a good Rockingham set up, so expect that car to be right up there.
Well, it's not fast on the first lap. 23.951 is slowest so far.
Well, Felipe used to have a good setup for Rockingham. I don't know what happened.
These guys had a good run at Daytona last
week. Boy, they did. He was doing a whale of a job. So many guys were having great runs, rookies particularly, until the big crash on the back straight. Well, we got a little loose off the four there.
But let's keep in mind, Hornaday is a rookie, so he banked a safe first lap, and this lap is much better. 23.799, 153.8. He is 10th fastest. Dick Berggren?
In eight prior appearances in this event, Jeff Gordon has qualified in the top five seven times. How good's this car?
I think it's good enough to get in the top five today. We didn't show it in practice. Went out to make my qualifying run and overdrove it. I think if I can, you know, get the thing to turn, getting in the corner, we're going to be in real good shape.
Okay, well, Robbie Loomis has thrown some new things underneath this car to try to get some more speed out of it.
Still working on Michael Waltrip's car to get him ready for this race. On track is Sterling Marlin in the number 40 Dodge. That's the Chip Ganassi Felix Sabata's entry.
You know, he's had a tough week. People have been on his case all week about being involved in the crash with Dale, and it wasn't, you know, Sterling didn't do anything wrong. He just racing hard and racing to the finish of the Daytona 500, and I hope people cut him some slack and get off his case, because that's a hard thing to have to deal with.
Not very good through turn three and four. No, I think he overdrove the entrance and ended up way up the
racetrack. He did, and then it pushed it. No, you see him wobbling there. He's pushing loose is what he's doing. He's got the thing bobbling all over the place. And he's just trying real hard.
23.779, 10th fastest on his first lap, 153.9.
A little better through three and four. And
the car's loose, so it's just kind of sliding all over the place.
He's only had one top five start in 31 Rockingham races, and he won't get one this weekend. His second lap is slower.
I would think that the Dodges would have a lot of work to do on the downforce tracks. I think they focused a lot on Daytona, and it showed. I think they got work to do on these other racetracks.
Steve Park, Bobby Labonte, Ricky Rudd, and Johnny Benson are the fastest. Winston Cup qualifying continues in a moment on Fox Sports Net. Rookie Jason Leffler from Indianapolis. The Chip Ganassi 0-1 Dodge is on the speedway. Completes his first lap, 23.909, 153.1 miles per hour, and this is his first trip to Rockingham.
Yeah, and he's struggling. I mean, the car is not as comfortable as I'm sure he'd like for it to be. He's a rookie, and he's just got he's doing a lot of work in there unnecessarily. The car needs to be better.
He was 20th fastest in practice this morning.
He's working without his regular crew chief. Remember, Kevin Cram got suspended for 4 weeks after Daytona, the fuel infraction. Andy Graves, who's a veteran crew chief, is looking after him.
Second lap's a pretty good one, 23.738. 154.2 moves him up to ninth.
See, I expect the veterans to get their good lap in on the first lap. You would expect the rookies to do better on their second lap. They get settled down. There's Ray, and he's walking around. He's got the three hat on, paying tribute to Dale. And I know that Ray misses Dale just like all the rest of us do.
Evernham said earlier this week, he said, if we win Rockingham, it won't be like we beat the best.
You know, I want to say something about the NASCAR Winston Cup garage area. I don't know about other sports, but when you're trying to outrun each other, you won't find a group that will go after each other any harder. But when a race team's in trouble, a driver gets severely injured or even killed, you won't find a closer-knit group of guys in that garage area.
This is family. These people spend more time amongst this group than with their own neighborhood or perhaps even with their own extended family.
Well, it affects so many people. It's so far-reaching. The people that work on the cars, the owners of the cars, the sponsors of the cars, the fans, NASCAR is so far-reaching when we have something happen like what happened.
Here is Matt Kenseth in Jack Roush's number 17 Ford. He did not have a good practice time, as you heard earlier.
That race car is loose off the corner. The back end is not sticking.
It's up the track, and it's getting up there in that gray area, and it's just pushing and loose, and he's just got his hands full.
His first lap wasn't good, and the second was worse. 23.928, 153.0 for Matt Kenseth. Ken Schrader walking toward his car, getting ready to qualify. Bill Elliott out on the line. Mark Martin, Jimmy Spencer. All part of our extended family.
And there's no question what they're talking about. They're not talking about setup, chassis, how good you're running, or anything else. They're talking about what Dale would, what would Dale be doing right now? What would Dale be saying? What would he be saying?
Whoa, Mike Skidder. I don't think he had four wheels below the line going into one.
No, but he had half that car below the line.
Now, Darrell, during the race, will you occasionally dip the left sides under the white line for a purpose?
Oh, yeah. Mike's car is another one of those that's just bobbling all over the place.
And you're going to hear it say pushy loose a lot. What that means, Darrell, you get down in the corner, the front wheels aren't biting. You got the wheel turn. Finally, the front wheels bite off the corner, the rear wheels unhook.
There they go.
And that's a product of a lack of grip. And, of course, we got a harder tire here this time. And we got a little, the track's not cold. The sun's out, so it's not cold. But we don't have an optimum temperature, I don't believe.
Skinner is slowest on his first lap, and his second is quicker. But he is still 17th of 17 drivers. And
the way that car is rocking around, I mean, it's like he's got a way too much rebound in his right front shock. Watch it, Larry, as he goes off in there. Of course, when you're on the apron, it's pretty hard to tell what's going on.
See, when he went through the transition, he shot it. Now the back end's coming around. Now the front end's not sticking. It's just not sticking either end.
He's all over the place. Here he goes down into one, and he's trying to catch that white line just right with those left side tires. He just gets in too low. The left side unloads, and he's got to fight it back in line.
Steve Burns.
Hey, we've caught up with Kenny Schrader. Kenny, it's been an awful week. How do you feel today back at the racetrack?
Just feels good to be at the racetrack. This week seems like it's been about 3 weeks long. I mean, seems like Daytona was a month ago, but just good to be back here.
Car good?
The M&M car was good. It was brand new. We had never tested it, hadn't made a lap. It was about 14th in practice, and if the driver doesn't screw up, it'll go a little faster.
Thanks, Kenny. Hey.
Terry Labonte on the racetrack. Our hearts go out especially to Ken Schrader and Mike Skinner. Those were the two drivers who both stopped at the accident scene. Schrader was part of the accident. Skinner was instructed by his and Earnhardt's coroner, Richard Childress, take another lap around, stop, tell me what's going on. I can't get any information. And I think their memories of what happened are more vivid than the rest of us, that Richard Childress' team probably feels this loss more than any other at this speedway. If Mike Skinner is last in the qualifying line, please don't attribute that to performance. There's just a lot more forces working here, folks, than how you put that car into the corner and how well it's prepared and performs. Steve Park is fastest. Bobby Labonte is second so far. You're watching qualifying on Fox Sports Net. Every weeknight, Totally NASCAR here on Fox Sports Net. Steve Burns brings you up to date on all the news of NASCAR racing. 6 p.m. here on Fox Sports Net. Bobby Hamilton in the Andy Petrie number 55 Chevrolet.
He was a little nervous down in turn one himself. All these cars, I really think it's a product of these tires that we have here this time. There's just not enough heat in them when they take the green flag. And then they get the heat in them and the news off of them by the time they get their second lap. So it's a real dilemma to be in.
Second lap is slower. First lap will be the lap of record for Hamilton, 23.742, 154.2 miles an hour, 10th quickest.
Figure this out. They're too cold on the first lap, and they're too hot on the second lap.
Wow.
But that's basically what they do. They lose so much grip from the first to the second lap that even if you run a better line and the car feels better, you go slower.
Jeff Hammond?
Yeah, Mike, sitting here watching, I'm just seeing where it seems like the times are continually, the guys can't back up their early morning practice deals. And if you remember, this is one of the first times we've qualified this early during the day, so actually the guys that are going out later are having to see a hotter racetrack, where normally when you qualify like it used to a year ago, we'd be qualifying in the afternoon, and the guys that had the later numbers would have a better draw and would get a better chance to pick up their speeds. So it's kind of like the guys that went out first got a lot of benefit this morning with the cooler temperatures.
And let's remind folks, there was no practice yesterday afternoon. All the practice has been early this morning when it's been extremely cold.
And also consider this. These cars may struggle qualifying, but this harder tire will make a better race. This tire, after it gets heat in it and gets some laps on, it'll make a better race tire.
Ricky Craven on the speedway.
He was good through three and four, too bad.
No, first lap in that Cal Wells 424.097.
He's wobbling down here. Yeah. He's wobbling too much.
Now, one question I want to answer for the fans is how do they determine the qualifying order? Is it who gets there first? They basically take a thing like in a bingo parlor. You walk up by how you finished in the points last year, and you draw a number, and that's how you go out. And I know you wanted an early number this morning.
Yeah, I thought that too, and that's going to hurt Michael.
Larry, that's a good point you bring up, buddy. And things that the fans don't get a chance to see is that's quite an art. A lot of guys, they have guys that kind of like have a feeling, who's lucky today? Who's lucky? Who can get the number? And if you ever get on a roll where a guy can choose and say, I want to go out early, and he can get that number, you send the same guy every week. And sometimes when everything's kind of going haywire and everybody's drawing bad numbers, you can't find anybody who wants to draw it. So a lot of times they'll let NASCAR do it for you.
Kind of like being at the craps table.
There's no question. We let David Smith, our team
manager.
What's
Jeff Gordon doing back there? He's not even...
He's not up to speed.
He's coming around. He's going to throw away this lap.
That's what he's going to do, because it's important getting up to speed, coming to take the green flag.
Okay. Ricky Craven was 19th fastest.
I think it... see, Jeff backed off. I can hear it way back here. He's going to get some heat in those tires. He's got a different approach to this thing than everybody else has had.
This is a Daytona-style qualifying for Gordon, where he's using his first lap just to get up to speed, but not to abuse those tires.
I think that's the plan. He probably went out with a little bit lower air pressure, get some air pressure built up. Now he's going to come down and he'll stand on that bad boy.
It's probably not going to be a good lap, but he really got through three and four coming to take the white flag, which is important.
Yeah, well, he's got his momentum up. He wants to get a run to the flag, and this will be interesting to see how it works out. I wondered if anybody would try something like this.
First lap, 24.033. 20th quickest. This will have to be the lap for Gordon.
It's there too, buddy.
A little slower through three and four. Tires lost some grip.
And he is...
He's on the pole, though.
Quicker!
He's on the pole.
It's there. All right, now
23.401. That's 9/1000ths faster than Steve Park.
Now, if I'm a crew chief, I'm going down my driver. Oh, throw away the first lap! Throw away the first lap!
Yeah.
Let's go trackside.
Well, Mark Martin is one of the most successful drivers in the history of Rockingham Speedway. Between Busch Series and Winston Cup, he's won 13 races, 11 poles, but this is a different day. How tough is it for you to focus on racing today?
Well, I don't really know about the focus, but, the dark, empty hole inside, really makes for a different feeling for all the competitors, and they're all carrying it around. It's hard to explain it, but there's some empty spot inside that just sort of takes everything out of it. We're all doing our jobs just like we do, every week, but we feel different about what we're doing.
To get back to the job at hand, Jeff Gordon just threw his first lap away, put it all on the second lap. Is that a good strategy for you?
I can't do that. I've programmed for 25 years for getting the fastest lap. I'll get everything there is the first lap, and most likely I won't even take a second lap. Personally, I want to keep that extra lap off my tires because I'm probably going to have to start the race on them. Every lap makes a big difference. My game plan is to go out and get everything I can get the first lap and not run a second one and save that lap on those tires in case I have to start the race on them.
Hope it works for you. To Steve Burns.
Thanks, Dick, with Mike Skinner. Mike said you want to hurry up and get working on that race car. Tell us about your runs.
We made a pretty major adjustment. We were like 26th in practice, and we knew that we wasn't nowhere near pole material, but we felt like to get in the top 10, we were going to have to do some pretty major stuff. And we threw some things at it, and we definitely went the wrong direction. The car was extremely loose, drove it plumb off the racetrack down there trying to catch it the first time, and kind of threw that lap away. Well, two laps will still be okay, and it was spinning the tires plumb up off the corner. It was just way too loose for a low Chevy today, but we're going to get in here and start concentrating and focusing on the race setup, and hopefully we can make it come from the back to the front. Thanks.
All right, Dale Jarrett has run ninth fastest in his Robert Yates Ford, and now on the speedway comes Joe Nemechek in the Andy Petrie number 33 Chevy. First lap, 23.887. 153.2, 20th.
You know, thinking about what Jeff Gordon did and seeing what these cars are doing, that was a really, really, really smart move. Because everybody's bonsaiing into turn one and the cars won't stick. They don't have enough heat in the tires at that point. And then they get the cars all wobbling and it just puts additional heat in the tires too quickly and you lose your grip. So that was a really intelligent thing to do.
So he was using his tires instead of abusing them.
I tell you what we do. We air the tires up to qualify. That's what you do for one lap. We put additional air in them. I bet you Jeff went out at something like maybe a pound or two under, lose that first lap to get the pressure up, then he gassed it.
We'll find out in a moment. Joe Nemechek ends up 15th from his qualifying pass. You're watching it on Fox Sports Network. Welcome back to the North Carolina Speedway. Hutch Strickland and the Jimmy Dunleavy Ford is on the speedway. Jeff Gordon has snookered him by throwing away his first lap and using his second one as his speed lap. Gordon is 9/1000ths of a second faster than Steve Park for the pole.
And this is a car that's got to go because he's way down in the provisional list and he can't afford to have a bad qualifying run.
And he was slowest in practice.
Yep.
So definitely, you've got 45 cars here no matter what. It's a 43 car field. Two cars will be going home.
And this could be one of them. That first lap of Strickland's was only 24.193, 151.3 miles an hour.
You know, I want to go on something that Mark Martin said and make a clear in there. He said he may have to start the tires that he qualified on. The top 10 qualifiers, they have to start the race by NASCAR rules on the cars they qualify. And what this is to discourage possibly teams from doctoring or softening these tires. And with a harder tire, that would be real important if you could soften them up.
Strickland's second lap is faster, but he is still the slowest driver to qualify. Matt?
And Mike, Jeff Gordon threw away that first lap. But was there some debate on whether to do that after you saw some of the other times?
Yeah, you know, when I saw some of those guys like Bobby Labonte and Steve Park doing it on their first lap, I was, you know, a little concerned that maybe the temperatures are rising. You could do it on the first lap, but I heard some guys also saying that the grip wasn't there. And I felt all along, you know, during practice that I felt like the second lap was going to be the best one, but you had to give up the first lap if you're going to do it on the second lap. And I thought I could just get a little more heat in the tires and a little more momentum, and worked pretty good. I mean, the guys did a great job freeing the car up because we had been tight all day long, and I definitely was anything but tight right there. So great effort. We're real thrilled with that lap.
Do you run different pressures knowing you're going to throw away that first lap?
Not really, because, you know, it's not like I was really building them up a whole lot. It seems to like with this tire, you're not up as much as we used to be anyway.
Rookie Andy Houston on the speedway. This Cowell's Ford, 24.092 is first lap.
This is another car, only run a few races last year, way down in 2,000 owner points. He's got to qualify on the racetrack for this race.
And like many of the rookies, the second lap is quicker. 23.909 puts Houston 21st.
Pick up on what Jeff said. You got a harder tire, you don't want to air it up. It's hard already, and air just makes it that much more it makes it that much harder. So the harder tire, you want to run the air pressure down a little bit. And I don't know what recommended is down there, probably around, what, Larry, 40, 45 pounds on the right front.
I think it's they actually lowered the recommended with the harder tire. I think it's 42 pounds in the right front, 40 in the right rear, and about 26 on the left side.
And that's pretty low.
Now, the three slowest drivers so far, Ricky Craven, Mike Skinner, and Hutch Strickland, are not necessarily the three going home. The 36 fastest drivers from this qualifying will make the field. From the remaining nine, the seven highest in owner points from the 2000 season will be added to the field. And that's how the lineup will be set. Buck Shock Jones in the Petty Enterprises Dodge number 44. You saw him earlier watching teammate John Andretti run, and right now he's slowest to 24.208.
One thing about one round of qualifying Saturday morning, you don't have to stay up all night tonight worrying about it.
That's right.
And that used to happen a lot.
And again, the harder tire, you're going to hear us talk about this a lot. You know, the tire obviously is made of rubber.
Whoa! Man, he got her loose off of four.
He's not going to be very happy with that lap.
He's faster. He's almost 3/10 faster, 23.976. Think of what that lap would have been if he hadn't got loose up there.
Well, I think he was, you know, he knew, probably got a call on the radio, said, son, if you want to be in this race, you're going to have to step it up a little bit, and he did.
And that's when he comes in and says, it was going to be a good.
Yeah.
Here's a look.
This when your crew pats you on the back right here and says you did a great job. Whoa, man.
And I would say the reason he was faster is he got through the actual 3 and 4 corner faster, but the speed was too fast for the rear tires to grip coming off the corner.
Well, he was carrying so much speed out of that corner and trying to keep it off, keep it turned down the track, and it just snaps out Monday. But he did a great job of hanging on.
Kevin Harvick, who Richard Childress has tapped to fill the seat of the car that would have been driven here by Dale Earnhardt. Steve Burns.
Mike, we've been following the 15 car. Just talked to crew chief Scott Eggleston. They're going through qualifying right now. I said, Scott, how's it going so far? And he said, I don't know. I'll tell you in a minute if we make it through qualifying.
Robbie Gordon, Morgan McClure Chevrolet.
Now, what he's doing is I watched him go down in a turn is he's using a lot of brake, and he's loose off of two. But he's using a lot of brake to get in the corner. He's slowing the car down real fast and then trying to accelerate off.
14th fastest on his first lap. 23.770. Second lap is slower.
Quite a bit slower.
Yep.
This is the same car that Bobby Hamilton led so much of the October race when a distributor went out on him. So it is a good race car and certainly suited for this racetrack.
The three fastest, Jeff Gordon, Steve Park, Bobby Labonte. The three slowest, Ricky Craven, Mike Skinner, and Hutt Strickland. Dale Earnhardt Jr.
He's trying to carry on a family tradition. He's doing a great job of it. I've been proud of how he's handled himself. Yeah, standing ovation from the crowd as he goes by. He's got to be so emotionally unprepared for this weekend. Green.
But yet getting back in that car, something it's he's therapy. Familiar with doing, that's part of the healing process.
It's therapy.
Don't know about 1 and 2, pretty decent through 3 and 4.
23.777, 15th fastest, a credible lap.
He'll be okay with that. I'm sure he'll be not thrilled, but he'll be happy.
He'll be solidly in the field.
This a better looking lap, Larry. I don't know what his time's going to be like, but it's a better
quite
looking
a bit, lap. Quite a bit slower through 3 and 4, though.
And it's about 7/100 slower. So Earnhardt Jr., 15th fastest. Dick Berggren.
Kevin Harvick, your thoughts on this qualifying run?
I'd tell you what, this Goodrich car, just still trying to get used to it. You know, we ran Rockingham eats up the tires so much that we only ran a couple laps hard. So we're just going to go out there and give it everything we've got, and we don't know what we've got, so we're going to find out.
Okay, good luck with it, Kevin.
Thank you.
Mike?
Harvick will drive a Richard Childress car here. It will not be the familiar black number 3. Richard has put a moratorium on the number 3 for 1 year, and he says there will never again be a black number 3. Childress has the number 30 reserved for Harvick to run 7 cup races this year and the full season next. But Richard Childress said he did not want to come to Rockingham with a car that had a 3 anywhere in the number. 29 was available, and that's what they have chosen to run here this weekend.
Good lap right here, boys.
Tomorrow, Beyond the Glory, we'll take a look at the life of Dale Earnhardt, the greatest driver that NASCAR in this generation has known. It will air tomorrow at 8 p.m. on Fox Sports Net. Jeff Burton, the Jack Roush number 99, first lap's a good one, 5th fastest.
This car looked great on the first lap. It looked terrible on the second one. I think, though, a lot of guys, you know, they know the first lap's good, and they really don't maybe give it all they got on the second lap. If they know, they get a call on the radio, they know what they run, and they just use that second lap just for practice.
And Mark had a good point. If you think you're going to be in that top 10, you don't want to burn up those tires if you got it, if you banked a good lap.
That's right. There's Mikey.
The Daytona 500 champion, Michael Walker, will run a bit later on. You're watching Winston Cup qualifying on Fox Sports Net. Welcome back to the North Carolina Speedway, where Jeff Gordon, Steve Park, Bobby Labonte, and Ricky Rudd are fastest. Here is Jerry Nadeau.
Good grief. Either he is throwing away that lap, or he's missing his crew chief badly.
Now remember, he's teammate to Jeff Gordon.
Yeah.
So that may be the same strategy.
It may be, but he looked like he was trying pretty hard. We'll see here, but
first lap is slowest.
And he's working with a substitute crew chief. Gordon Gibbs, the car chief that looks after the car, will be in there for 4 weeks. Tony Furr, after the infraction at Daytona, on a four-week suspension.
Yeah. Throw away first lap.
Whoa, 23.633, 10th quickest. So he picked up a second, 1.1 seconds. So truly that first was a throwaway lap for Nadeau.
He pays attention to his teammate, doesn't he?
Cheers from the crowd as Michael Waltrip's car is being pushed to the line.
Winner of the Daytona 500. Man.
Backup car after a crash this morning in practice. Dick Bergeron with Kyle Petty.
Kyle Petty's one of the best time trialers of all here at Rockingham Speedway. Five poles, did it in six tries. How good's this car, Kyle?
I'm not sure about this car. You know, it's pretty good. The Dodge is good for us. It's been good for Buckshot. It's been good for John. We're just looking to find some consistency and find some base work or some a baseline right now. So that's the main thing. We just want to get these three cars in the race again down here, run all day long, get a good baseline, and we'll start racing a little bit later in the year, a little bit stronger as far as pole stuff and some of that stuff. Right now, we're just interested in making races.
Okay, good luck to you. Mike.
Jimmy Spencer, twice the national modified champion, had a brief stint in Busch before moving up to Winston Cup. This is Travis Carter's Ford. And his first lap is 23rd quickest.
And guess what? Jimmy Spencer is cussing Travis Carter's Ford right now. That thing was all over the place off of turn two there.
Way off the second lap.
Yeah, he's just, the car is really, really loose, and he's got his hands full. He's just hanging on to it. That's about it.
Second lap, 1,600 slower, so the first lap will be on the chart for
and
Spencer.
It's so frustrating when you go to qualify and the car's not with you. The car's not under you. Because you've got to drive it harder than you've driven it all day. You drive it harder qualifying than you do practice. And when the car's not there for you, the driver gets very frustrated and he just can't get his job done.
Rusty Wallace, the Penske Racing South Ford, number two.
Okay, Larry, what do you think? Has he got a chance?
I don't know. He was not very fast in practice.
No,
he was
35th.
Now, he holds a track record here. He sat on the pole a year ago, set a new track record. Now, that track record is about 2.5 tenths faster than Jeff Gordon right now. But, of course, again, we got the harder tire. Rusty was not very happy, especially he couldn't get going on his first lap this morning.
Yeah, he didn't look good in turn one at all. And he's up off the bottom off of two. Car's bouncing around a little bit. Now, he's still not happy.
Not throwing this lap away. Well, no, here's Wallace.
You figure he won 9 poles last year. That's a...
Yeah, 24th quickest, 23.868.
That's not a very good lap for Rusty. I know he'll be very unhappy.
You know, you talk about driving aggressive and qualifying with one round. Also another factor, if you're high in the points and you've got a little insurance, you can kind of go for that pole, overdrive it. But if you're down in points, you've got to get that conservative lap in.
Second lap for Wallace. No change, 24.1.
That may be in the last year anyway. That's the worst qualifying run I've seen that car make in a year. So they've obviously got work to do.
Michael Waltrip's car rolling in line. Tony Stewart among those waiting to make their runs. Jeff Gordon and Steve Park are faster. This is Fox Sports Net. Here's the Daytona 500 pole sitter, Bill Elliott, the Ray Evernham Dodge.
Car looks good. Hard to tell how fast it's going, but the car looks good. It's handling well. It's not all over the place.
And the first lap for Elliott is 11th quickest, 23.655.
I believe he held a little back. I thought he didn't come out of the pits real hard. I'm not so sure. I'll be curious to see if Bill picks up any on his second lap, but I think he held a little back. just watching him.
He's right down on the line.
Car really looks good.
A little slower through three and four and a little bit loose up off four on that second lap.
Yep.
And it is almost identical, 400 slower. Jeff?
Yeah, Darrell, one of the things that I was curious about, especially from the driver's perspective, you know, Rusty was so dominant last year when it comes to qualifying. I'm just wondering he's having a hard time adapting to this new tire and giving up his setups that worked so well last year.
Well, I think that's probably, you know, we hear a lot of people talking about they tested. A lot of people tested the first four races because they know they're on the new tire and they are going to have to make some changes. And Rusty's slow to change. He's one of those guys that's been around a long time. He got something that works. He hates to leave it.
Hey, Larry, doesn't that really kind of put the weight of the world on Robin's shoulders or any crew chief when a driver kind of like has to, you know, give me that tour, give it up, give it up?
Well, you know, when you got a good package and you continue to go back to a racetrack, it's hard to give that package up. But when you've thrown that curveball of a different tire, and the tire is one of the most important things on the car. It's what's touching the racetrack. It definitely, you're a little hesitant to change that setup, but you know you got to. Plus, the driver sometimes has to learn the different feel that's given him.
All right, Todd Bodine is on the racetrack. First lap for Bodine comes up 32nd quickest. Dick Bergeron.
Look, last Sunday, Tony Stewart took one of the wildest rides in Daytona Speedway history. End over end, side over side, backwards down the backstretch on top of another car. How are you feeling today?
Pretty sore. We've got two really good trainers that have been with us all week helping us out from Charlotte, and it's made it better, but I got a heat pad on my lower back right now, and my neck's got a lot of stiffness and soreness in it, but everybody's worked really hard to try to get us as comfortable as we can be in the car right now.
Can you make it all the way tomorrow, Tony?
I plan on it. I've only had to climb out of a race car twice in my life, and that's in 22 years, so I don't plan on getting out tomorrow. But, you know, all the guys that work really hard, you know, especially all the guys at the shop, you know, everyone with both the Home Depot team and Interstate Batteries team have really worked hard trying to make Bobby and I as comfortable in the car as possible. And we're running new seat belts this week that are a 6-point harness versus a 5-point, and puts a new, a different style of head restraint in there. So, you know, everybody's really conscious of what happened last week and just trying to do everything we can to make each other safe.
Absolutely.
Jeremy Mayfield was the next car scheduled on the racetrack. A little late going through inspection is Mayfield's car, so Kenny Wallace is on the speedway. This is the Eel River Racing Pontiac.
He was loose there in 1 and 2. He got the back end kind of swung out. I saw Tony in the hospital Sunday afternoon when I went over there, and boy, he was in a lot of pain. It's good to see him back to the racetrack. And Kenny Wallace is still looking for something to put on that big old white quarter panel back here.
And he's running pretty well, 23rd fastest, 23.810 on his first lap.
Told me he's having a good weekend. Said my Busch car's fast and my Cup car's going to be good too. So somebody's going to jump on side of that thing, aren't they, Mike? Larry?
I sure hope so.
I would think so. Again, this racetrack's just getting hotter and hotter. It's going to get harder and harder to run fast.
Well, Mike Wallace put $50 on it last week. I could come up with that.
I'd go in, $25 or $30 if there just wasn't too many people in on it.
I believe I can do that too.
You want to?
I think so.
Let's go down and see him. 23rd fastest for Kenny Wallace. Yeah, we could buy a valve stem or something.
Oh, yeah.
Rusty Wallace talking over with Robin Pemberton, explaining that qualifying lap.
And what he's telling me is that when I turn to the right, that is not the way I want to go.
Matt?
And Rusty, normally we see that blue deuce a little higher up in the standings. Any idea why it's not the time you were looking for?
Yeah, it's been out of control ever since I unloaded it. To tell you the truth, it hasn't been handling even close. And so right now we're going to put our race setup in it, which was real good for us the last race here. We start adjusting from there. We've got a long happy hour, so that's going to be good. And I feel comfortable we get the car right for racing. Just for qualifying, I ran out of time. In fact, right there at the end, I made 4 or 5 changes just try to help it, and the car was way too loose. And in some places, it was pushing the front end also. So we're going to take that qualifying setup and throw it away and do something else. This is a brand new car, and I feel real good about the car. I just got to get working on the setup.
Is it the harder tire or lack of testing, Rusty?
It's the harder tire which caused the problems. But, you know, if you don't test with the hard tire, and that really bit us. I just didn't think it'd bite us that bad. I knew we'd be off a little bit and we'd have to work extra hard. But it looks to me like all the cars that have tested are really flying, so it paid off coming down here to test.
All right, here's Jeremy Mayfield. His first lap is a throwaway, 24.59.
I'll say he wasn't even in fourth gear when he come off turn four, but his car still don't look very good. He's the pole sitter from the October race.
He looks pretty good now, though, bud. He's down there smoking around the bottom. And he's going to be pretty happy with that lap.
11th fastest, 23.637.
Considering that his teammate is back there 20-odd, and he's up in the top 15, I think he'll be happy with that.
All right, bumping will begin. On the bubble is Hut Strickland, who is 44th in car owner points and is slowest right now. This is an all-or-nothing run for Michael Waltrip. As a new team, the number 15 has no provisional points from the year 2000 to fall back on. He has to time his way into the show.
Yes, he does. He's the Daytona 500 winner. He's the leader in the points, taking the green flag. Come on, my boy.
And he was fourth fastest in practice, boy, way high. And you know, I was just gonna say, the worst thing about unloading a backup car at Rockingham is the possibility of the car bottoming out when you go off in the corner, and that'll just kill your whole lap.
So many things, the brakes could be not working properly. There's so many things that could be wrong with the car.
But you have to trust it, and you have to drive it on in there. So here's the first lap for Michael. 30th, 23.896.
He's coming around. He's getting with it now. He felt her out in the first turn. Woo. He got up against the fence off turn two. I tell you, the kid's driving his heart out, though. He's giving her all she's got.
Hut Strickland on the bubble.
It's going to be a lot better lap if he...
Real good through three
come
and four.
On,
he's going
to
hit a lot, but he got loose right there. Bam.
Then he hit the wall.
It's okay. That's okay, my man.
Second lap is sixth fastest.
All right.
Michael Waltrip. 23.563.
And that's awesome for this lady. Oh. He was digging as hard as you could dig.
He is pumped up, I'm telling you.
Let's have a look at it. Michael Waltrip.
Yes.
Ooh. Oh, might have clicked it. We'll be right back. Hut Strickland has been bumped and likely does not have enough car owner points to make the field. Here is Stacy Compton in the Mark Melling Dodge, number 92. Mike Skinner is on the bubble, but is high enough in the car owner points to make the show. Coming out of the Fox box at the top left of your screen will be the qualifying rundown so far, as Compton's first lap is only 36th fastest. Matt?
Jeff Burton, fifth fastest. How much of a handful was that car?
It was a big handful. You know, it's been real hard to concentrate this week. It was difficult coming in the racetrack today and getting back to business. I didn't do a very good job of explaining to Frank what I needed. I thought we needed to be freer than we needed to be, and I'm real proud of the lap because the car didn't drive very good, but we still got a good lap, so I'm real proud of that. That's a step in the right direction for us.
He has one win here at the Rock in the fall event, looking for a spring win. Mike?
Stacy Compton, second lap, moves up to 33rd. That will bump Mike Skinner.
Again, Mike Skinner finished 12th in the points last year. He'll be safely in the field through the owner points.
Here goes the 29 car, guys.
On the speedway is Kevin Harvick out of Bakersfield, California. This is the Richard Childress Racing Chevrolet.
And he is going to have something. He's going to have immediate fan support. He's going to have a lot of people pulling for him. And there's the monument for Dale right out in front of the racetrack out here. People have been so gracious and so kind to that family and what has happened. It just makes my heart feel so good.
The last time this race car saw the racetrack was with Dale winning Atlanta against Bobby Labonte in a photo finish.
Slack is 31st, 23.892 for Harvick. That should safely get him into the show. Now, this car will have the number three's provisional position if needed, even though it carries 29.
Kevin and his fiancée going to get married in Las Vegas this weekend.
He saw Michael do that. Worked for him.
Almost lost the car. And the second lap, as a result, is slow. So Harvick is 31st fastest. That bumps Todd Bodine, who is 39th in owner points and may be headed home. Let's watch this runoff turn four again.
It's all the way up on the straightaway, and that is what you call very, very loose.
Yeah, that is a product of trying to get back in the gas way over in the, before you even get to the middle of the corner, and carry a lot of speed off the corner, and the track won't hold it.
More speed than the tires will
take. Yeah, the tires and the track just won't hold that kind of speed. Good idea, just doesn't work.
So Harvick is 31st, and it moves Ricky Craven onto the bubble. They are 41st in car owner points. Dave Blaney in the Bill Davis Dodge, teammate to Ward Burton, is on the track.
Blaney got down into one really good, and car looks good. It's around the bottom of the racetrack. He's hustling it pretty well.
Track getting slower as it warms up here. The sun gets higher in the sky.
It's a great time for right now.
It is 14, 23.705 for Blaney.
His crew chief told me that when Bill Davis went to the Dodges and started building downforce cars for tracks like this, this was one of the first ones that they built. Car really looks good.
Gets up. Yeah, up till then it did.
He thought he was at Eldora. He had that back end up against the fence like they do at Eldora.
You know, you're on the last corner of the two laps, and the tires just really lose grip there, and you get very loose.
So Blaney's first lap is quicker. He is 14, and bumping Ricky Craven. You're watching Winston Cup Qualifying on Fox Sports Net.
Cat in the hat.
Buckshot Jones is on the bubble in the Petty number 44. Here is Casey Atwood, the rookie driver in Ray Evernham's two-car Dodge team.
And he did just, the kid drove his heart out at Daytona. He did an absolutely masterful job. I think he's going to have a great year working with Ray. That's going to be exactly what he needed, was a veteran like that. Good lap, too.
First lap for Casey, 20th fastest.
With the sun beaming down the way it is, that's a good effort. I think he lost a lot of time on his second lap.
Many of the rookies have been quicker on their second lap. And Atwood is, but only by less than 100th, 23.766. He's still 20th fastest. Matt?
Michael Waltrip and Scott Eagleson talking things over. Michael, in a sport that requires just so much focus and concentration, can you begin to describe how difficult it was to climb behind the wheel?
Well, this is where we all want to be. You know, we want to be back here working. Being in the car is the easy part. It's getting to get in it. That's difficult. And I just lost sight of the goal this morning. Our goal was to come here, make sure we qualified, and try to win the race. And man, I tried to win the pole in practice, and that was just a dumb thing to do. But I'm glad it happened in practice. If it had to happen qualifying, you know, everything happens for a reason is my belief. And whew, what a lap. I was all over the place. I hit the wall again, and it just worked out, and I'm thankful.
Darryl said you almost gave him a heart attack.
Oh, man, Darryl can appreciate that is as loaded up as I could ever be. Winning the Daytona 500, I had 500 miles to work that out. To even be here on Sunday, I had to do it in two laps. And wow, just thank the Lord for this team. Steve Meal, right in here digging with us. Scott, this car, I tested with it. And Scott, right before I went, he said, you ran a 57 when you tested the last time you were in it. Go run us another one of those. And I did it. I ran a 56. And I'm just thankful for my team. And tell Teresa I'll be here tomorrow.
Big sigh of relief down here in the 15 garage, DW.
Yeah, that is. People just don't know. When he said loaded up, he's not over-exaggerating one bit. That's so much pressure to put on a guy to go out there and get the job done in one or two laps. Not much strategy there, is it, Larry?
No, there isn't. You just got to reach down and get all you can. Boy, talk about this car that owned this racetrack in the early 90s. They talked earlier about five poles here. He also, I think, won three straight races here, too. He pretty much owned the place.
Oh, he was the man to beat. Kyle Petty was the man at this racetrack.
Well, that was a Pontiac. This is a Dodge. This is a Petty Enterprises car.
He's got the same line that he had in that old Pontiac.
Yeah, right around. You wasn't going to pass him going in or underneath.
No, but he's going to have to pick up the speed a little bit.
Previous to Kyle, Mark Martin clocked in 15th fastest in his Jack Roush Ford, 23.563. Or excuse me, 15th fastest, 23.721.
And this is another car. He's got to pick it up. He's got to get all he can because he don't have a provisional. He's got to qualify on the racetrack for this race.
And you can believe they just called him coming off of turn two and gave him his time, and he knew he had to speed it up, and I don't think he got quite enough.
He did not. Kyle is 38th fastest, 23.996.
And again, I want to explain what we keep talking about, the track heating up, why the cars run slower. The sun's beating down. It's not just temperature. The sun's beating down, really raising the track temperature. And this racetrack is like a piece of 80 grit sandpaper anyhow. It just wears the tires out. And when the sun's beating down on it, the oil and all the grease in it is just coming up, and the car just won't stick. It just slides around.
And this guy would be a pole contender if the weather hadn't gotten changed enough to keep him from it. This car will be fast.
Folks, 80 grit is not sandpaper. It's big chunks of rock paper.
That's about what it
That's
is.
That's how rough it is.
That's right.
Sharp rock.
I still believe we're going to see a good race, though. I think this tire will make for better racing. Qualifying, it gives the guys a little bit of a problem, but I think they'll race well.
Tony Stewart and the Joe Gibbs Pontiac.
Good lap.
Sixth fastest, 23.550.
That is a real good lap.
It is for
We've only
now.
Got Tony, and we got one more car, I think, Ken Schrader, and qualifying to be in the books here. Right around the bottom. Yeah. Little bobble there,
Yeah,
though.
He got her a little loose there. Probably hurt him.
Yep. Stewart completes his run, and the second lap is slower, so he's sixth fastest. His teammate Bobby Labonte is third quickest. Kenny Schrader's had to wait through all this line of qualifiers to now go on the racetrack. After a heart-wrenching end to the Daytona 500, rumors of retirement circulated this week, but, you know, Schrader probably runs more races than in a year in different types of cars than anyone in the Winston Cup garage.
There's been times when things haven't gone my way and I get down and depressed and kind of dejected and I'd want to retire too, but once you have time to get all that under control, cooler heads prevail and you come back to the racetrack. That's the best place for you right now. This is the best therapy Kenny could have, especially if he has a good run.
Right now, on the bubble is Andy Houston. If Schrader is faster than Houston, he goes home along with Kyle Petty and Hut Strickland. So here's Schrader. Will he bump Andy Houston? He does. 15th fastest, 23.705.
So if there was a team that was pulling for Kenny Schrader to run fast, it was the 90 car of Junior Donlay,
yes.
Because between the 90, the 96, and the 45, he was higher in points.
Right. Even 36 spots are filled through qualifying, and Schrader's second lap is slower. So the ones that missed the cut were Andy Houston, Matt Kenseth, Stacy Compton, Kyle Petty, Buckshot Jones, Ricky Craven, Todd Bodine, the 31 of Mike Skinner, and the 90 of Hut Strickland. But those will be sorted out by owner points, and we'll let you know who stays and who goes home when we come back. Jeff Gordon has won the Bud Poll for Sunday's Winston Cup race here at Rockingham. We'll be right back on Fox Sports Next. Jeff Gordon wins his 34th career Bud Poll. It comes in his 259th Winston Cup race. Steve Burns is with him.
Jeff, congratulations on the pole. Tell us how you did it.
I don't know. You know, we were pretty good in practice. We tested here. You know, and I guess that strategy worked of throwing away the first lap. But we've been pushing all day long, and the guys really freed it up. We had awesome horsepower, and I think it was just meant to be, you know. And I got to say that we're missing Dale, and that's, you know, this one's for Dale, man. You know, I think that he must have been driving the car for me out there.
It's Gordon's second Rockingham pole. When he won the pole in February 95, he went on to win the race. In fact, 11 of Gordon's 52 wins have come from the pole.
Boy, not a Dodge in the top 10, but parity in the first three rows, two Chevrolets, two Pontiacs, two Fords.
Yeah, I think Gordon's going to have a great day tomorrow in there. There's the Dodges, 22, the 9, the 93. There's Jason Leffler back there in 21st position, so... they're back there. They're looming in the back.
Again, new qualifying procedure. Only one round of qualifying, two laps of qualifying.
Kevin Harvick in the 29 car, the last car to get in by qualifying time.
And the irony is that Buckshot Jones, number 44, has the 44 car's points from last year. And those points mean he's in the field, but his owner, Kyle Petty, goes home along with rookie Andy Houston.
Well, I believe if you was asked Kyle, if one of the Petty cars had to go home, Kyle would volunteer. That's the sacrifices he has made for that team and for that company for quite some time now.
Closing comments from Chris Myers.
All right, thanks, guys. And Jeff Hammond, this day started with a lot of emotion. Michael Waltrip having a wreck in practice. He does okay to qualify the Daytona 500 winner, of course, in an Earnhardt car. And that's going to be the theme as we head into tomorrow.
Very much so, Chris. What you're seeing right now is these guys from DEI have rose to the occasion. They have responded. All the guys are in the top 25. But Michael Waltrip, you can't say enough about Mikey. I'm telling you right now, he was in a pressure cooker and he came through.
All right, so it should make for a very emotional race on Sunday. Don't forget, just about a half an hour on FX will continue to pay homage to Dale Earnhardt, and then the Alltel 200 starring the best from the Busch series. Following that on FX, the Winston Cup happy hour here from Rockingham. It's the last practice before tomorrow's Rockingham 400, and tomorrow we'll have more on the memories of the Intimidator starting at 12:30 Eastern on Fox, and then it's the race itself. Mike Helf, president of NASCAR, will join us live prior to that race. So Jeff Gordon on the pole for the Rockingham 400. And a number of racers, drivers paying homage to the late Dale Earnhardt. For all of us here, we'll see you over on FX and on Fox for the race tomorrow. From Rockingham, thanks for watching. Take care.